Hey everyone, I'm Derek Clark, elder at Bethany Baptist Church, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about who we are in Christ. If you're a Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ, hopefully you know that our faith is quite a bit different from any other one on the planet. Pretty much every other religion, it's all about what you need to do for God in order to gain salvation or get to nirvana or whatever the ultimate goal is in that relationship. In Christianity, it's really about what God did for you, or for me. Maybe you've heard the phrase that Christianity isn't really a religion, it's a relationship. And that relationship is between Jesus Christ, the creator of the universe, and you, or me. If you had a chance to listen to my devotional about a month ago, I spoke about the scarlet thread. As a reminder, the scarlet thread is really the idea of how Jesus and his redeeming blood show up through the entire Bible, from Genesis to Revelation. And in talking about how Jesus shows up in each book of the Bible, we basically wound up covering numerous characteristics and attributes of Jesus. We learned about how Jesus is our reigning king, our redeemer, our hope, our life, and our coming king, and several other attributes we covered at the time. We essentially learned a little bit about who Jesus is. So I thought a natural follow-up would be to look at the other half of that relationship, us, and dig into who we are. More specifically, who does Jesus or God say we are? So often, we as Christians forget what our identity in Christ is and make the mistake of allowing our identity to be defined by someone or something else, like our spouse, our kids, our job, our looks, our bank account, political beliefs, or any number of other sources. But that's dangerous territory, because no one is perfect. No thing can truly give us worth. It's very important that we find our identity in the one who created us and loves us more than any person ever could and gives us more worth than any treasure on earth could possibly give us. So before diving in to who we are in Christ, I think it's important to remember who we are or were without Christ, because that's how we all start out in life due to our sin nature. If you're watching this video and you don't currently believe in Jesus as your personal savior, the next couple minutes might be difficult to sit through, a lot of hard truth coming your way, but I urge you to bear with me, because the couple minutes after that's definitely more than worth it. And for those of you who already follow Jesus, this will be a reminder of where we were and where we still would be if it wasn't for Christ's grace in our lives. So what do the scriptures say about who we are without Christ? So just a few examples I found in the Bible include Psalm 14:1. The fool says in his heart, "There is no God. They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is none who does good." Proverbs 24:20. "For the evil man has no future, the lamp of the wicked will be put out." Ephesians 2:1-3 says, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, and were by nature children of wrath." Hebrews 11:6 says, "And without faith it is impossible to please him," him being God. Revelation 21:8, "But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." Did you catch some of the adjectives that the Bible and biblical writers use to describe us when we don't know Jesus and don't have that personal relationship with him? Words like fool, abominable, evil, dead, children of wrath, etc. It keeps going on and on. That's our identity when we don't know Christ. Charles Spurgeon once summed it up when he said, "You cannot slander human nature. It is worse than words can paint it. Without Christ, we are hopeless and helpless. There's nothing we can do." But if you don't know Jesus as your personal savior yet, there's actually really good news. He didn't leave us here to fend for ourselves. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, Paul says, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures." Jesus died on the cross, taking the full punishment, full wrath of God that was meant for us. so that we might have salvation through him, through Jesus. So how do you obtain that salvation? Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. There's nothing we can do on this earth to earn our salvation, to earn our way to heaven. Jesus did it all. He paid it all. All you have to do is believe, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord of your life, that he died for you, that he conquered death through his resurrection. Because of that, we're able to live with him forever. So the moment someone makes that decision to follow Jesus, their life is changed forever. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. We already looked at who we are without Christ, and it's obviously not pretty. So what does it look like when that old does pass away and we are made a new creation? Once again, we'll go to the scriptures and see what they have to say. Psalm 37:30 says, the mouths of the righteous utter wisdom, and their tongues speak what is just. So in Christ, we're righteous. You're wise and just because you know that Christ is your Savior. Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So in Christ, you're no longer sentenced to death and separation from God. Your record has been wiped clean, and you have eternal life with God. John 1:12, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. We just read a couple minutes ago that without Christ, we're children of wrath. But in Christ, that wrath of God has been completely quenched by Jesus' sacrifice, and we are actually now called his child, as opposed to a child of wrath. John 15:15, no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. So in Christ, you've gone from never being able to please God to being called his friend, someone who God delights in and wants to spend eternity with. And then finally, 1 Corinthians 1:30, and because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So we see again here that in Christ you're wise and you're righteous, but Paul adds in this verse that you are sanctified, which means that you are holy or set apart for a special purpose by God. And then you are also redeemed, meaning Christ paid an enormous price to free us from the slavery of sin. So these verses show us how Jesus views those who know him, which means it's how we should view ourselves if we know Jesus. This is our identity. Doesn't that sound so much better than if you don't know Christ? No matter what your life is like, whether everything you touch turns to gold or you can't seem to stay out of your own way, this is our identity. Our identity in Christ keeps us from pride, realizing that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, as James wrote. Our identity in Christ keeps us from becoming overwhelmed by life's struggles. David wrote in Psalm 40, I waited patiently for the Lord to help me, and he turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on solid ground and steadied me as I walked. So if you know Jesus as your Savior and you made it through this whole devotional, I'd love to hear in the comments section how you stay tuned in to your identity in Christ. What aspect of your identity in Christ is most encouraging to you right now? And if you don't know Jesus as your Savior and have any questions about what that means and want to talk about it more, please feel free to reach out to me or any of the staff or elders from Bethany. Would love to talk to you. We can get you their information or contact information. Or maybe you have a trusted Christian friend already that you know that you would be willing to talk to. There's no better time than now to think about eternity. Thank you all, and God bless.